short exhaust coming on the back of those episode cylinders with a Skinner radiolator. And so, wonderful noise in the air, as you will see. Across the thing in our back of the tractor, the console needs to be on the video. The problem there is, of course, one particular huge pilot goes off. The other aircraft is getting ready. There's one there as well.
Later on, a few of them had de Havilland Gypsy Majors as well. Although Tracy's Ryan is painted in the colours of the US Army Air Forces, they never actually operated this machine. It was the sole surviving prototype of the aircraft, which was kept in the Ryan business or the family for a long time before somebody bought it in France, and thence it came to Tracy. The Copper Swift is particularly relevant to our collection here as well, because Richard Shuttleworth owned one and did some quite significant long distance flying in it. This is not an aeroplane, but he is one of the comps that was well known in the racing circles. In fact, it was owned by Alvin Ali, an Indian gentleman, who again did a lot of long distance in this particular machine. When you look at the copter, you might think the pilot can't see out of it because he's sitting behind the pylon that the wing is carried on. And Keith Dennison's flying it today, and I asked him what it was like, and he said, it's quite surprising, an aeroplane. He said, it looks like you can't see out of it, but in fact the view out is pretty good because the pylon itself is quite slender and the pilot can see either side of it. So that's no particular problem. Directionally, he said, it's actually quite difficult to handle directionally, to keep it flying, pointing straight ahead. The pilot has to work quite hard at that. And also, the elevator forces, the stick force, the up and down, forward and aft stick motion, so it's got almost no force to it. He said, it's... the only aeroplane he's flown that's like that. Let's see.
Where we got to in our time machine, by the way, ladies and gentlemen, we're back in the 40s there with the Mustang. Back in 1929 with the Compo Swift, 1941 with Orion. As I said, very much a wartime trainer, the Orion, with the United States Army Air Corps. Shortly to become the United States Army Air Force, and shortly then after the United States Air Force. That was a big training base down in New Mexico, quite called Fort Malamon. And one of the weird things about this generation of people, if you throttle these back, then you've got this really alarming bright red exhaust plate and a loud popping noise, and all of them into the back of the future. And one of the flight instructors of Dr. Alamos was taking a student over the city one night on his first night flight. He was trying to calm him down because obviously he was aware that the kid in the front was probably scared stupid first night flight, and it's quite a powerful and fairly ill-mannered aeroplane for a trainer. You don't want a trainer to be too easy to fly. You want it actually to have a bit of quirkiness, a bit of what we call character, in order to actually teach pilots, you know, that it's very dangerous to get low and slow and so on and so forth. And he decided he was going to calm the pupil down, and he chucked down this little thing called a dashboard tube. He's got a speaking tube in the back cockpit. It's connected to a pair of earphones in the front cockpit. It's one way only, the student cannot turn him off. And occasionally, the nastier instructors would hold the end of the open tube out the slipstream. So the student basically got a blast of freezing cold slipstream there, right in the ear holes, which used to wake the students up, something beautiful. Anyway, he shouts to the student, "Isn't the city pretty at night?" and points over the side. Student can't hear it, so he throttles back, and of course you get the bright red popping flames and the loud noises. The student turns around the bar, sees the instructor pointing over the side, shouting at him, "So what is it?"
As these two aircraft come by individually, you can hear the difference in engine note. I was going to say that before the last pass, but all I could hear was the Polikarpov running up behind me. It was a very, very loud engine indeed. But do get to listen to these two machines. Now as the Ryan turns in, you can hear what Tim was describing earlier, the engine note of the Kinner engine, followed by the rather smooth note of the Popjoy and the Compo Swift. Compo Swift. the time I flew it, we weren't allowed to use full power on the engine, so it really had a much less than sparkling performance. But they grounded it shortly after that, sorted it out properly, and it now goes very, very well indeed. So I didn't fly it in its latest guise, was able to use full engine power. From the 1930s.
You can see the next pair of